my home shall be eternal. To a land sweet view of land. I'm looking now across the river where my faith will end in song. There's just a few more days to labor. Then I will take my heavenly flight. You I'm longing for you, and someday on thee I'll stand. There my home shall be eternal. You alas, with you I see the light, I hear the singing, a lovely song of joy divine. My soul rejoices just in knowing that Sunday's play shall be mine. Beulah land, I'm longing for you, and someday on thee I'll stand. There my home shall be you.
Someone have a number? Number five. Number five. Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, the triumphs of His praise, my gracious Master and my God. Assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad the honors of thy name. Jesus, the name that charms our fears, that bids our sorrows cease. His music in the sinner's ears, His life and health and peace. He breaks the power of canceled sin. He sets the prisoner free. His blood can make the foulest clean. His blood avails for me. There is a fountain filled.
sinner's cloth beneath that blood loose all their guilty stain. Loose all their guilty stain. Loose all their guilty stain. And sinners flung beneath that blood, loose all their guilty stains. The dying thief rejoiced to see that fountain in his name. I hope that blood was shed for me and washed my sins away. And washed my sins away. And washed my sins away. I hope that blood was shed for me and washed my sins away. Dear dying Lamb, thy precious blood shall never lose its power till all the ransomed church of God be saved to sin no more. Be to sin no more. Be saved to sin no more. Till all the ransomed church of God be saved to sin no more. Ere sins by faith thy soul was free, thy holy wounds apply. Redeeming love has been by thee and shall be till I and shall be till I die, and shall be till I die. Redeeming love has been my theme, and shall be till I die. When this poor list springs stammering tongue lies silent in the grave, then in a nobler, sweeter song I'll sing thy power to save. I'll sing thy power to save. I'll sing thy power to save. Then in the nobler, sweeter song I'll sing thy power.
4:21. Number 421. I heard no
story how a Savior came from glory, how he came to life on Calvary. I heard about his glory, of his precious blood of atoning. Then I repented of my sins and saw the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He saw me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about his healing, how his cleansing fire revealing, how he made the lame to walk again, and caused blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. Somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and loved me with his redeeming blood. And all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory, and I heard about streets of gold beyond the crystal sea. About the angels singing and the old redemption story, and some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and loved me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
We have 179, 363. We'll do 363 and 179. Three 363.
Some glad morning when the spark is all around, fly away to a home on that celestial sound, fly away, fly away.
For the opportunity that we have to gather ourselves together in the house of the Lord the pillar and ground of truth. I hope and trust that as long as the day may have been for you, you know, you've been to a worship service in between time, and now we gather ourselves back together, a new time that we would be in continual prayer for our meeting this evening, being in prayer for our visiting elder, Elder Luke Laird. It's good to see him. Nice to meet him from Tuscaloosa, Alabama. So we're thankful that he's here along with his wife, Sister Jessica. So we welcome them. I hope they are made to feel at home, and that the Lord would bless him as he comes forward to preach the gospel to us here this evening, that the Lord would just rain down upon him with a portion of his grace and bless him as he stands before us, and bless each one of us with a portion of his spirit, that it would be made new and fresh to us, the victory. You know, we the hymns, the worship service that we just had in singing of these psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, making melody in our heart to the Lord. Aren't you thankful for these hymns that we're able to sing? I'm thankful to the Lord for our faithful song leaders. We just sang some of the most wonderful words that we could sing. Sing about Jesus, sing about victory, sing about the victory that he giveth us. Isn't that wonderful? That as Jesus was victorious, we are victorious with him. I'd like to welcome Elder Loudermilk with us once again. We're thankful for his fellowship and friendship that he was able to arrange this for Elder Laird. It's good to see Elder Carelock as well. We're thankful for his fellowship and supporting this meeting and this church. It's good to see him and his family as well as Elder Loudermilk's family. As we come together this evening to worship, we have several that we want to go to the Lord to make mention of before we go to the Lord in prayer. We want to remember Brother Mike Udy. He's in the hospital. He had a severe infection on his right toe, his big toe on his right foot, and he is scheduled for surgery tomorrow sometime to have that toe removed. We want to be in prayer for him and his recovery and the doctors and surgeons. So we pray the Lord's blessing in that. Remember Brother Mike Udy. Sister Renee broke her foot. Is it her right foot? A bone in her foot?
I think it was the left foot.
Left foot. She was walking down the hallway and it snapped and popped and broke. And she is due to see the doctor on Tuesday, I believe it is. So we want to remember Sister Renee as well. It's good to see each one of you, our visitors. Thank you so much for being with us tonight. We want to continue to remember Sister Ruth and Sister Virginia, Sister Wanda, Sister Jewel, Brother Gene. We want to continue to be thankful for them. Brother Ned Honeycutt is now at home, from what I understand, so we're thankful for that. We pray the Lord's continued blessing upon Brother Ned. Chase Nichols and his soldiering overseas, we pray the Lord's continued blessing with him, that the Lord would watch over all the places that he would go, and that he would feel the presence of the Lord with him as he serves the country. Sister Merlin, we have a few from No Creek we'd like to mention. Sister Merlin, pray the Lord's continued blessing with her, as well as Sister Bennett, Brother Jonathan, Sister Liv Massey. We mentioned Ronnie Hendricks' grandson. He's, what'd she say, a year old. He had some heart issues earlier in his life, and now he's going through some other complications. So we want to remember Ronnie's grandson. So be in prayer for that. If you would, try to remember him and that family. Is there anyone else that someone would like to call out?
Could I ask everyone to please remember Elder Bobby Payne's
wife? Bobby Payne?
Elder Bobby Payne's wife. And Elder Mark Quarles' wife, Sister Emily.
Elder Mark Quarles' wife, Emily.
Elder Bobby Payne there from Alabama, his wife, Sister Pat.
Okay, Sister Pat. All righty. Be in prayer for them. Is there anyone else? Well, I'm anxious to hear the preaching this evening. We pray the Lord's blessings upon it. We'd like to stand and sing a hymn as a way of opening and ask Brother Ronnie if he would open service with public prayer and followed by Elder Luke Blair to come forward to preach for us. Power and demonstration of the Spirit. Brother Gene, what number?
Number 36.
Precious privilege that you've given us to come in thy house with thy people to worship thee. God, we beg at this time and beseech thee at thy throne that you, in your mercy and your long suffering toward us, allow us to feel thy presence once more. God, we thank you so much for the rich blessings that you blessed us with in times past. God, we confess that we've been unworthy of the least of those blessings. God, we pray at this time that you would once again look upon us, not with an eye of judgment, an eye of long suffering and mercy, and come and allow us to fellowship with you. God, we come before you believing. We come before thee in boldness, believing that thou art able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. And we know, God, that thou art able to bless and help all those that have been mentioned in prayer requests. God, as the leper once said, if thou wilt, thou canst heal. We pray, God, that you would bless them and be with them. And we pray, God, that you'd hear our prayers. God, we thank you, Lord, for the pastor of the church here at Meadow Creek. God, we pray, Lord, that you bless him in his effort to shepherd the flock. God, we pray, Lord, you bless him with the Spirit as he lead and guide the people in this walk here in this world. God, we pray, Lord, you bless the services tonight. God, we have heard Brother Luke in times past. We've heard and preach the gospel in a mighty way. God, this is a brand new time. And we pray, God, that on this evening, that you'd fill Brother Luke with your Spirit, that you'd loosen his mind from the cares and thoughts of this world, that he would focus on thy word. And I pray, God, you'd loosen his tongue and be with him so that he can preach thy word in a mighty way. And I pray, God, you'd bless our ears and our minds to be open, that we could receive thy word, and it be a strength to us as we face the trials and the tribulation of this wicked and perverse world. God, as we go forward, God, we beg for thy help and thy mercy. We have nowhere else to turn but unto thee, under the hills, whence cometh our help. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Brother Eddie was opening services. He made mention that this is the ground and pillar and ground of the truth. Pillar and ground of the truth. Think about a pillar. A pillar doesn't do you much good unless it has good ground. You don't have a foundation, nothing else really matters, right? You can build a house. It's not built on the foundation. That house is going to fall. This house is the pillar and ground of the truth. I put up pillars all the time. I go out into the woods and find a place I want to hunt. I dig some holes and put some pillars up and put a platform on the top of it so that I'm elevated. So we should be elevating the truth, right? That's what the church should be doing, the ground and pillar. We should hold up the truth. We should stand for the truth. If it's going to be the ground and pillar of the truth, if we are called to serve him in spirit and in truth, if we are called to have no confidence in the flesh, and I'll tell you, there's one thing that must go forth, and that is the truth of the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The truth. Now, we're to illuminate that and hold that up. In Jeremiah, I quoted, and you know, we looked at that, but I want you to know this, that this ground and pillar, there's got to be a foundation for the pillar to be set upon. And it is to elevate that which is true. Now, this morning we looked at why we should stand. Okay, why it's important. What I'd like to look at, and I'm sorry for those of you that wasn't there, but just this is what I got, so this is where we're going, is the fact that we should stand. Okay, that we should stand. Now, in Jeremiah, it says that, he says, stand ye in the old paths, wherein is the, that is a singular pronoun, the good way. Now, here's a pretty good place to be looking for the good way. You know where you're going to find the good way? In the old paths. All right, so if you're looking for the good way, you can't be looking in a new path. You got to be looking in the old paths, because that's where the Lord says you're going to find the good way. Brethren, there are not multiple good ways. There is the, that is singular, okay? That does not mean there are many. A lot of people got this up. Well, we all trying to get to the same place. Now, that's a lie. Straight out of the pit of hell. It's not. That's just as plain as I can tell you. There is one. He is the way, the truth, and the life. That's it. In the old past, there is the good way. There's not a bunch of different options that you have in the ways. It is one, singular. I hope we get that point. Yeah. The good way. And if you're going to find the good way, wherein is the ground and pillar of the truth, not multiple. Well, you got to live your truth. I don't know where they get some of this stuff. There's one truth, brethren. There's not multiple truths. You don't have a truth. I don't have a truth. There's one truth. God's truth. Jesus Christ is the truth. There's only one. There's not multiples. And you see, we get into all kinds of trouble when we get to entertaining these crazy ideas. Because these crazy ideas lead us to there being multiple truths. There's not multiple Christ. There is one. Brethren, I'm going to tell you this one was all it took. You could have crucified 1,000 Luke Larrett's. Wouldn't have done a thing in the world for your eternal atonement. You crucified Paul, Peter, John, Moses, Abraham. Don't matter. Fill in the blank. Stick them in there. It's not going to matter. Only one matter, and that's Jesus Christ, who hath, past tense, forever perfected. Now, I'm going to tell you how you mess that up. I love to cook. I really do. But yeah, I've enjoying your salad to cook made back there. It's made, I suppose it's made that. But anyway, the point is this. I love to cook. And one time I had cooked this, I don't know if it's a jambalaya or a gumbo or a chili. That's my kind of stuff. Etouffee, maybe, I don't know. But that's what I cooked. And Sister Jessica tried it, and she said, that's perfect. You know, Sister Jessica left out of that kitchen. I'll put your little party out in there, you know. You put a little boom. You put us a little extra cayenne. And when we put that thing on the table, she took a taste of it. This is what she said. What'd you do? She said, what'd you do? All right, so what I want you to understand is when something is perfect, a good way to mess it up is to add something else to it. All right? We can't add anything to the perfect, completed, finished work of Christ, because when you do, you mess it up. You see, he didn't say when he and whoever else purged our sins. It says when he by himself.
That's right.
Now, I'm going to tell you, my brothers, they used to get mad at me. Daddy'd leave him go offshore when he was working overseas in Africa. There's a list of things around there that need to be done. I'm going to tell you, I was a pretty rough taskmaster for my younger brothers. Because the quicker we get this task list done, the quicker we could get about doing what we wanted to do. And Daddy was gone for 28 days. If we could knock it out in 2 weeks, we'd have 2 weeks to ourselves to do what we wanted to do. So I would line them out. Daddy'd call it, hey, did you get this done? Yes, I just got done. Did you get that done? Absolutely. My brother said, it's funny, you tell him you got to. I said, I didn't say that I did it. I said, I saw to it, it got done. I divided the labor, gave you a job, your job. I took a job, we all done our job, got it done. He didn't say that he saw to it that it got accomplished. It said that he by himself, okay? You can't add nobody to that.
That's right.
He by himself purged us and purged our sins and iniquities. All right, I'm going to tell you, he cleansed us by himself. As a matter of fact, he looked and there was none to help. Matter of fact, he looked, you know, a lot of times we get this crazy idea that, well, here's what election is. You know, God looked down through the annals of time upon the children of men to see who was going to be good little boys and girls, and that's who he put his grace upon. Well, he did. He did look down through the annals of time. This is what he's found. There's none. Good, no. Not one. Not a single one of them. Not a single one of them are good. Every one of them are polluted. They polluted themselves. Not only are we polluted ourselves. Not only are we sinners by nature, we're sinners by commission, brethren. And if we fall short of one part, we fall short of all parts. I remember when Samuel goes to Saul, and he tells Saul to go over there. Now, I want y'all to think about this. I want to run down this line for just a moment. Samuel tells Saul, you go over there to those Amalekites, and you destroy everything that's over there. Now, you don't bring anything back. People? Nope. Houses, goods, animal, nothing. Everything is to be destroyed. Oh, I got a good idea. Let's bring the best sheep and the best calves back. And see, Saul been listening about old Saul's killed his thousands, but David is thousands of thousands. You know, that probably got under his skin a little bit there. So he brings old King Agag back too, so people can see what a great victory that he's brought. And the Lord comes to Samuel and said, you go ask Saul why he didn't do what I told him to do. I'm paraphrasing here, but I'm getting the point. We're going to grab this real quick.
Yes, sir.
He said, go ask him why he didn't do He said, it repenteth me that I set him up to. It breaks my heart that he's done what he's done. I told him, I gave him a command. He didn't do exactly what I told him to do. And Saul comes to Samuel. He says, Samuel comes to Saul. And Saul says, I don't know what you're talking about, Samuel. I've done exactly what the Lord told me to do. And he said, what meaneth the lowing of the cattle and the bleating of the sheep? You ever heard them in your life? Boy, I have. You know what he says? Like we all do. He said, oh, the people. Them people, I'm very sorry. They want to bring them things back over here. It wasn't my fault. He didn't say nothing about him bringing Agag. The people wanted to bring him. You know, he asked him a question. He said, is God more pleased in burnt offering and sacrifice or in obedience? He said, I tell you, he's more pleased in obedience. Now, let me ask y'all a question. Judgment has been passed upon these beasts. You know what God said? Destroy them where they're at. He didn't say bring them back. Do you think in any way, shape, form, or fashion, even if they had offered them as a sacrifice, that they'd have been pleasing to God? No. You know why? Judgment had already been passed upon them. If they would have been worthy to have been sacrificed unto God, God would have said, you get them, bring them over here, and offer sacrifices to me. He didn't say do that. He said destroy them over there and don't bring them back. He makes a good point there. Because this is my question to you. Left in and of ourselves, in our flesh, Paul says, I know as in me that is in my flesh dwelleth no good thing. Me left to myself, what do I have to offer unto the Lord? What can I offer? You see, judgment has already been passed.
That's right.
I'm no different than those animals that was told to be destroyed over there. Judgment's already been passed in my case. Because the consequence of sin is death. You break one part of it, you're guilty of all of it. But praise God that when we were yet enemies, he sent his son made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law. Because why? Because he loved us, brethren. And he redeemed us when we were enemies. You understand? We were enemies. That's not a friend of God. That's not seeking after God. That's someone who is diametrically opposed to God. And when we were enemies, he loved us and died for us and saved us. That's amazing. Those animals wasn't worthy to be brought back. You know what? I wasn't worthy to offer anything. But now, hath he made us kings and priests unto God. That's amazing. Something that wasn't worthy of being sacrificed, now I can offer up the praise of my lips. Now I, by the Spirit of God, can pray in the Spirit. I can sing in the Spirit. And I'm going to tell you, brethren, if I hear anything, it's in the Spirit. And if the gospel's preached, it's because the Holy Ghost come down. Everything we have is in this Spirit. Because aside from that, brethren, we're like those cattle and those sheep. We're not worthy to be brought back. And I marvel at how thrice holy God could look upon such a sinner as me with compassion and love and mercy and grace. But he has. And because he has, I need to understand what that means. What is that? I understand this. I know that if the Lord hadn't have done that for me, I sure couldn't have done it for myself. I understand that aside from the work of Jesus Christ, I was a bankrupt, corrupt sinner deserving of a place called hell. But by his amazing, unmerited favor, his grace, he hath withheld that which I did deserve. Praise God for his mercy, right? His mercy is everlasting. Man, that's good stuff. I'm glad it ain't gonna run out, ain't you? If it was going to run out, it'd be better. We couldn't sing that song when we've been there 10,000 years. Well, you know, we've made it a few days, and we just hope that mercy don't run out. We don't have to worry about his mercy running out because he didn't do it forever. And what the Lord doeth, he doeth forever. He said, I've loved thee with everlasting love. I'm going to tell you, brethren, if you didn't understand anything else about God, but if you understand that he loves his children with an everlasting love, and there's nothing, and I mean nothing, that to separate them from that love. If that don't give you security and put you on high ground, won't nothing do. That right there will set at liberty the captives. That right there, I'm going to tell you, when you realize you've been delivered from yourself, despite what you deserve, ooh, that'll make your soul fly. Now, we've got all that in Christ, right? But here, we're the ground and pillar of the truth. You know, we shouldn't be ashamed of the truth. And it happens all the time. Sometimes I bet when you're younger, somebody say, I love for somebody to tell me. I love to get this way. What's the difference between y'all and us? Well, let's just sit down, man. I sold a camper to a man. I bought a camper from a man. Let me get that straight. I bought a camper from a man. I went to this man to buy this camper and went and looked at it, told him what we was doing. Man, he gave me a good deal on the camper. I was a priest of it. And he said, you meet me on Monday, and we'll meet at the bank because they've got the title there. I said, well, I'll bring the money. So I come up there, and I had the money. And I brought the money there to the bank. He said, oh, man, I'm so sorry. They don't have the title here. They're going to have to say, I don't know when it'll be here. And if you want to just wait. I said, look, man, here's the money. Shake my hand. I said, possession is 9/10 of the law. I'm going to fix the care of this camper for the house. And when the title comes in, you call. 7 months passed by. I forgot about the title. Wasn't that big a deal. Wasn't like he was going to take it. I was sitting in the camper. You know what I mean? It'd be pretty hard for him to take it. But when I come back by, he told me, he finally got my number. He said, hey, brother, look, I got that title. I said, well, good deal. How about I come by there Sunday after church? That'd be all right with you. He said, that'd be fine. I come by there and poor Sister Jess, he was sitting out in the car. He said, man, I'm glad you're here. 2.5 hours later, Sister Jess just sitting in the car. The air conditioner was working. But I'm telling you, this man had a lot of questions. You know what he said? He said, I found me one of them primitive Baptist churches. And I've been going. He said, what's the difference? I said, well, you know, I said, I guess it's suppose the main difference is I actually believe that Jesus done what he said he was going to do.
Amen.
He said, huh? I said, well, I want you to know this. I said, I want you to understand this. I said, Matthew 1:21 is one of the greatest truths in God's word. She shall bring forth a son. Thou shalt call his name Jesus. For he shall save his people from their sins. I said, there's some truths set out in this one little text that it would do us well to pay close attention.
Amen.
I said, first of all, she shall bring forth the son. This son is the only begotten of the Father.
Amen.
Thou shalt call his name Jesus. He's Savior. He's the deliverer, right? He's a redeemer. You can't call a fellow who tries to save a savior. You got to call one that did save a savior. You see, that's an oxymoron in and of itself. You can't call him a savior if he can't save unless you let him save. I'm telling you, he's either a savior or he's not a savior. And I'm telling you, he's a savior. And that's why we worship his great and matchless name. If you don't understand what shall, you know what shall means? I said, God's the only one who can use this word, really. I mean, I can say I'm going to shall do something, but I might not shall do it, right? I mean, I'm going to try with the best of my ability. But the problem is this. God, who cannot lie, promised before the world began. Hey, God can't lie, brother. God cannot lie. Promise this. He secured it. How don't you understand something about this work? This work is so important that he didn't just leave it up to some Joe Blow or some little Mississippi Flyboy or some Georgia, whatever he was, I don't know. a machinist, I don't know. Hey, he didn't leave it up to us. You see, this work is important. And he shows us that in God's word. You know, in the 5th chapter of John 5:25, he shows us who does the operation of regeneration.
That's right.
He says the hour is coming and now is. That means it's happening right now, it's happening in the future.
That's right.
He says that the dead, now that dead right there, brethren, is dead in trespasses and sin. The dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God. That's a shout. You know why? Because he's the one that calls them. You know how he knows who they are? Their names were recorded before the foundation of the world. That's how he knows who they are. And he, the hour is coming now is when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and they that hear shall live. Man, praise the Lord. That's good stuff. You know why? I don't have to worry about trying to make it. It didn't say the hour is coming now is when some poor, pitiful little bankrupt preacher is going to tell you about the name of the Lord and preach the gospel to you, and then you're going to believe. That's not what it says. The hour is coming, and now is when the dead shall hear, now get this, the voice of the Son of God. You know, I got this thing where I had this account set up. You know, you got to dial into these things. You have to put your password in there. Well, I get in there the first time, and it says, we want you to repeat this sentence after us. And I was like, this is going to be interesting right here. But me and Siri, we don't get along too good. But anyway, you know what it was doing? My voice has its own little fingerprint. You see, my voice is as unique as my fingerprint. Now, you might hear some folks that sound similar, but the problem is when you break it down and put it on the spectrum, it's got its own little frequency, its own little nuance, and it is specific. Now, I could imitate something. Like, I'm going to give this instance. You know, the Lord says the wind bloweth where it listeth, not knowing whence it cometh, nor whether it goeth. So is everyone born of the Spirit of God. I remember watching that movie called Twister when I was a kid. Y'all remember that when the dude was chasing the tornadoes? And supposedly that belt held him to that old well head while it was. Anyway. They made it look like there was a lot of wind there, but you know, there really wasn't any wind there. It was simulated, emulated. It was fake. Made it look like the wind. Oh, man can make things look like the wind. I'm going to tell you, we can't command the wind. You see, and for one to be born, it says, so is everyone that is born of the Spirit of God. We say the wind bloweth where it listeth. You know, here's been my challenge. If you think you have the power to wield eternal life, the next time we have a hurricane, go right on down there to the coast and just say, peace, be still. And when that hurricane stops, then I'll follow you. But until that happens, I'm pretty sure I'm going to follow the one that has the power to speak, and even the winds and waves obey his voice, because he can command the wind. We understand the wind sovereign. Doesn't take us long to figure that out. You go down there and say, hold up there, Katrina. You're probably going to die. It's your time. I'm telling you. You see you, pal. You know, you're not going to be there long. But Jesus Christ spoke, and they marveled. What manner of man is it? I tell you what manner of man it is. It's the only begotten of the Father. It's Lord of lords and King of kings. But more so than that, he's our Savior, our kinsman, Redeemer. He's our atonement. He's our high priest. He's our prophet and our king. He's our elder brother. He's our faithful counselor. And I'm going to tell you, brethren, there's coming a day when he's going to convey us home.
Amen.
John 5:25 says, the hour is coming now is when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and they that hear shall live. This work of regeneration, it didn't say that here about his voice. It said it here, his voice. His voice is specific to him. Guess who it's got to come from? Got to come from him.
That's right.
I can tell you about his voice. I can tell you what his voice does. But I can't emulate or make his voice. Won't happen. Why? Because it's his voice. Oh, I've had, you know how it is. A lot of people emulate a lot of people and try to. But even though you sound kind of like them, you're not their voice, right? This comes from him. Then he goes on to say, marvel not at that. He says, that's pretty amazing. But I got something even better for you now. For the hour is coming, that's on out there, when they that are in the graves, now we know what he's talking about. He was talking about spiritually dead over here. He's talking about corporally dead right here. The hour is coming when they that are in the graves shall hear the voice of the Son of God. Now, I'm going to tell you a beautiful thought I got regarding this matter. And they that hear shall live. You see, when an individual was regenerated and brought from death and trespass sin to alive in Christ, it happens by the voice of the Son of God. When we are called forth ultimately, and if the Lord tarry long, we all too will be laid. This old body will be laid in the tomb. But praise God, my spirit will be wafted away home.
Amen.
But the Lord is going to come back, and he's going to bring all the spirits of the saints with him.
That's right.
And we that are alive and remain shall not prevent them that have gone on before. And he's going to call those bodies out. You know, I just think if he's got such an important work, I can't help but think this, that if the work of regeneration is so important that the Lord does it himself, and the work of the resurrection is so important that the Lord does it himself, I just got to think it's just as important when a little child of promise goes home that the Lord has part in that as well.
That's right. I believe it too.
I just don't believe he leaves that work to just anybody, you see. He carries us home, brother. You know why? Because he said he was going to fetch home again his family. For him to fetch him home, he got to come away. Me and my dog had a hard conversation about that word fetching. You don't understand what it meant. Fetching means you go from here to there and back to here. Don't mean you go pick up whatever you got and go where you want to. It means you come back to me. So if the Lord going to fetch home again, he going to come from there to here and back to there and fetch home again his baggage. That's a two-way trip, brother. It's not a one-way trip. It ain't a sideways trip. It's a two-way trip. He comes here and gathers us and carries us home. These blessed truths, brother, are foundations. These blessed truths are some ground and some pillar that holds up the glorious truth. And that is the absolute completed finished work of Jesus Christ. I want you to know, brother, there was none that could help him. And he didn't look for any to help him because he knew the answer. The work was too important to leave this. Y'all ever been like that? I got to learn to delegate. I don't do too good at it. I like everything to be just so in a particular way. And I got to learn to delegate and say, look, brother, just cut the grass over here and make sure it's like this high. Whatever I want. I got to learn to delegate to do those things. But when I want something done right, I'll be honest with you, I just do it myself. A lot of y'all might be the same way. I don't know. But if I want it done a specific way, it's probably best me just going to do it the way I want it done and not have to tell somebody else about it and have to redo it. That's just wasted work. The Lord's work that he does is so important that I'm going to tell you, he doesn't leave it up to anybody else. He does it himself. You know why? If he left it up to us, we'd mess it up. Now, these things, hey, what's so different? Well, he accomplished what he said he was going to accomplish. He shall save. All right? His people. That word his is a possessive pronoun. You know, somebody told me one time, I left my watch sitting in the weight room. One boy said, hey, I found a watch. I said, no. No, you stole the watch. It's my watch. If I'd have found it, I'd been finding it. You stole it. I had to have possession of it for me to find it, right? It was mine. I knew it was lost. He didn't know it was lost. He couldn't find it. He just stole it. He come across something that wasn't his and took it. I said, that's called stealing, son. We ain't going to have that. That's mine. I'd have come across it. I'd have found it. I'm telling you, man, that his children, that's a possessive pronoun. I'm going to tell you, he fetched them home. When he said, it is finished, he says, I came down from heaven. Yes. Not to do my own work, but the will of him that sent me. And this is my Father's will. He doesn't leave us ignorant regarding this matter. Yeah. He says, all which he hath given me. And I told that fella, I said, don't you understand something? That little statement right there tells me that God the Father gave God the Son a people. Mm-hmm. He said, I never heard that before in my life. He said, well, don't God just love everybody? And now you know one of this conversation for 2.5 hours. But I said, does he love everybody? He didn't even have a King James Version Bible, bless his heart. I told him to go get one, do him a whole lot of good. If he'd get one of them, he might could understand some things. But whatever perversion he had, he went and got it. And I said, just flip over to the 9th chapter and let's check that thing out. And it actually used the word hated. Most amazing thing. He said, I never heard that on my life. It says hated right there. I said, I'm just as surprised as you are, to be honest with you. I said, I didn't think I'd have left that in there. I said, I know what the KJV said, but I didn't have a clue what that thing said. I said, so I'm just as shocked as you, brother. He said, man, I never heard that. I said, you know, I said, we shouldn't marvel when the Lord should hate anybody. I said, because we ought to understand that. You know, we should understand that we fall short of one part of the law. We're guilty of all the law. We should understand that there's no way that a sinner can stand before God and live. I said, but what we should marvel at is that God has made a place by him. God's made a place by him. Just like that old prophet, he said, I want to see you, Lord. He said, no man can see me and live. He said, there's a place by me, though, on the rock. And when I pass by and my wrath comes, because you can't stand before me and live because you're a bankrupt sinner. He said, I'm going to place thee in the cleft of the rock. And I'm going to place my hand over you. And when I pass by, you can see my glory.
Amen.
I'm going to tell you, dear saints, God still has a place by that he's placed his children upon the rock that is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And he placed us in the cleft of the rock. And because of that, brethren, we're going to stand before him holy and accepted in the beloved. And I don't know a lot of things about what heaven holds, but I got news for you. I know this. That when he appears, we shall appear like unto him. When he appears, we're going to be satisfied. And when he appears, we can see him with our eyes and not another. I'm going to tell you, brethren, that blessed truth right there will allow your soul to soar while you live in this world. Now, there's a lot of things you got to do to get out of the way in a temporal sense. You know, the Lord says, I'm going to show you a wise man. Let me show you a wise man. Luke 6. He said, a wise man is one that hears my words and does them. He said, let me tell you what it's like. Now, I want y'all to get this particular illustration. He uses two men in consideration here. Can you imagine? This one man, you see, he got out there. I made mention this morning of Zerubbabel here. For who has despised their small things, they saw the plummet in the hand of Zerubbabel, and he's laying out that great plan there. Anyway. Can you imagine coming by and you got this guy standing out in the middle of the field? You see him out there? You see some little flags and things like that. And you pass by. You keep passing by. Then one day you come by there and you see that guy with a wheelbarrow out there. And you think, what in the world is he doing? He's just driving, walking back and forth the wheel. Just you looking out over the horizon, look just as flat. You see, but that man is digging down. He's getting all the earth out of the way. Because he's got to get down to the rock. He got to get down to a solid foundation. So he spends his time digging out first. My grandma used to tell me, son, there's only one job. You start on the top and work your way to the bottom. You can either dig graves or ditches. Other than that, you need to get an education. That's what my grandma would tell me. But anyway, this guy's out here digging a foundation. He's got to dig down deep to get to a solid, and then he puts rocks back in the hole. So that it's a solid foundation. Now, he's been laboring and laboring and laboring. You've been passing by, see, he's going back and forth, had no idea. Then all of a sudden, beams start hitting the ground because, you see, they're laying on those pillars of stone that have gone down deep. You dig down deep to find good, solid, right ground, the rock of the foundation. Then he lays those pillars. Then he starts building the house. And this other guy, sees him building the house. That's pretty cool. I'm going to go build me a house. He just goes out there, puts some beams on the ground, starts building the house. Not if, but when. When the storm comes, guess whose house failed? The one who didn't have a foundation. Now, brethren, won't you understand something? The church, the pillar and ground of the truth. If it's not on the rock, Jesus Christ, it's just come some kind of social event.
That's right.
It ain't the ground and pillar of the truth. If it ain't founded on a rock, it ain't holding up the rock, then you might as well join the YMCA or something. This is the ground and pillar of the truth. It should hold up the truth. It should be founded on a rock. Now, we, sometimes in our life, in a temporal way, it's not pleasant. Y'all ever dug post holes? I don't know if you ever dug them. It ain't fun. I bet it's real bad in y'all's part of the country. We don't even have rocks where I come from. I mean, we got some gravel and such, but not like y'all get. I mean, y'all probably dig down and you got to get something, bust a hole in a rock to be able to get further. But what I get into is you throw them post hole diggers down there, and when you pull them out, that stuff stinks to them, son. You can't get it off with a, you can scrape and kick and do, it just, that old miry clay just stinks to it. That's where I come from. I'd rather dig a hole that was hard than I had that mess. I'm telling you, work yourself to death trying to shake the mud off the end of the post hole diggers. But the fact of the matter is, that's hard work to dig down deep. And when you're digging through that clay, man, it's sticky and it'll make a mess. It'll get all over your shoes and you'll see little patches of it in the house from time to time because you didn't get it all off and things like that. That's the way this old flesh is, brother. It's messy.
Yeah, yeah.
It's messy. But we got to dig down deep and try to get as much of it out of the way as we can so that it's on the rock. Because, brethren, I'm going to tell you, the Lord hath forever placed you in the cliff of the rock. He's ever prepared a place since the foundation of the world, a place by him, near unto him, on a rock, so that we can commune with him. And I'm going to tell you, we can have that communion here in the ground and pillar of the truth, but we got to stand. We got to stand on the rock. We got to hold up the rock. And when that happens, then the church is being the ground and pillar she's called to be. And when that happens, glorious things happen. You know why? Amazing things happen in the presence of the Lord.
Amen.
You know where he says he's going to be? In that place that he calls the ground and pillar of the truth. I just want to be there every time he says. Now, I don't know that he's going to be there every time, but just perhaps that he may. I don't want to miss an opportunity. May the Lord bless his heart.
Amen. Amen.
Yes, sir.
We're thankful for the message that we've heard. We're thankful that it was about Jesus Christ. We're thankful that Christ is that sure foundation, the chief cornerstone that can't be moved. Thank you. Larry, we appreciate it so much. We published the doors of the church open here for the reception of members. And when you think about what you've just heard, that he shall save his people from their sins, Christ did that. He said he did that. That's the truth that we uphold. The Apostle Paul told Timothy, let us not be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Christ said that. He did that. He accomplished that. And we're secured in him forever.
Amen.
Forever. Aren't you thankful that if you're part of the pillar and the ground of truth, that the truth never changes? You know, there's a lot that think they're a part of the pillar and ground of truth, but they come up with different things all the time because they're not based on the rock.
Right.
They're based on the sand, and it's just shifting all the time. So may God add his blessing. We're thankful for what we've heard. We're thankful for our Savior Jesus Christ. Brother Gene, what number do you have?
Number 67.
Number 67. Brother Luke, Brother Ronnie, come on down. If you want to shake hands, Elder Carrollock, come join us. Number 67.
My heavenly home is bright and fair. I feel like traveling home. Your pain, your death, and interdependence. I feel like traveling home. Yes, I feel like traveling home. I feel like traveling
on. God bless you.
My heavenly home is bright and fair. I feel like traveling.
God bless you.
It's clearing as the sun outshine. I feel like traveling home.
Praise the Lord. God bless you. God bless you. Man, good to see you again. Y'all come see us now. I'm looking for it.
Traveling home.
God bless you. God bless you, brother.
Thank you, brother.
God bless you. Good to see you again. God bless you, brother.
Enjoy.
Good to see you again. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Praise the Lord. God bless you. So good to see you. God bless you. Well, praise the Lord. God bless you. So good to see you. Thank you so much.
Yes, I feel like traveling home.
God bless you. So good to see you.
God bless you. God bless you.
God bless you. We enjoy being with y'all so much. Thank you for that. Card and this gift card, I appreciate it. So, my brother, man, God bless you, son. Good to be with you. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you. Glad to be here.
Good to have you.
Oh, I feel like traveling on. Yes, I feel like traveling home. I feel like traveling home. My heavenly home is bright and fair. I feel like traveling home. The Lord has been good to me. I feel like traveling home. Until that blessed home I see, I feel like traveling home. Yes, I feel like Just
This opportunity. We're thankful for our visiting elder. Remember him as well as you can. I'm so thankful that you have, I didn't have much to do with this arrangement, but you know, history shows us that, you know, we invite elders to come visit with us. They pray about it, and if they're able to come and they can work it out and the fullness of the Lord, they just come to preach the gospel to us without a charge. Aren't you thankful for that? If you had to pay for it, you couldn't afford it. You wouldn't have the price for it. But it's given to us freely. Lord willing, Elder Oos will be here with us on Wednesday evening. I'll be in prayer for that. There'll be no Creek Thursday and Friday. That's the plan. We pray it's up the Lord's will. Any other announcements?
If I could, I'd like to make just a few announcements. Our plan is for the second week in August, that's leading into the second Sunday of August, Union Grove Friendly Baptist Church, be our communion meeting. We invited Elder James Isaacs and Elder Mark Quarles to preach that communion meeting for us, and we're hoping everything will work out. I spoke with Brother Eddie tonight, and maybe get one or both of them to stay over to come to Meadow Creek that Sunday evening. The fifth Sunday of August, which is August 29th, and we haven't discussed anything other than Sunday, we'll have Elder John Scott at Union Grove Friendly Baptist Church. Also, I know I've had several people ask me, and yes, the Fall Smoky Mountain meeting, we're going to try to start on Wednesday evening, which is November 3rd. It has Thursday services, morning and evening services. That means 10 a.m. and about 7 p.m. same on Friday, and then not have anything on Saturday morning. And we've got several preachers invited to come, but I've asked Elder Doug Meeks, who's the pastor at Taylor's Creek, Friendly Baptist Church there in Gas City, Indiana, right outside of Wayne, to come back with me from the Smoky Mountains to North Carolina. And we're hoping he'll be at Larger Springs and spoke with Brother James that Saturday before the Sunday, and then Elder Doug will be preaching for us in the Grove on that Sunday. Thank you, Brother Ed.
Any other announcements? Ask Elder Kerloff if he closes with prayer.
Our Heavenly Father, mm-hmm. It's been a blessing to us to have been here this evening. Thank you for it. Thank thee for each one here. Thank you especially for the labors and efforts of this brother who's traveled distance. Pray for his safe travel, returning home, and also for the safe travel of each one that's local, realizing that every day we stand in need of thy providence. Lord, please give us things which we need according to thy wisdom. Please forgive us where we fall so short. Please bless us with repentance. Please bless us that we would, as we've been instructed, build on that rock, reaching for the truth of Jesus Christ in Scripture. Please bless our study. Please bless us to grow in grace and knowledge of the truth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 I'm going to go to the hospital.